Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Darwin Affair, a novel, by Tim Mason, read by Derek Perkins. We are living at a period of the most wonderful transition, which tends rapidly to accomplish that great end to which indeed all history points, the realization of the unity of mankind. Prince Albert of Saxe-Coburg and Gotha, Prince Consort of the United Kingdom. On the view of descent with modification, we may conclude that the existence of organs in a rudimentary, imperfect, and useless condition, or quite aborted, far from presenting a strange difficulty, as they assuredly do on the ordinary doctrine of creation, might even have been anticipated, and can be accounted for by the laws of inheritance. Charles Darwin, On the Origin of Species. God prosper long our noble queen, and long may she reign. Maclean, he tried to shoot her, but it was all in vain. For God, he turned the ball aside, Maclean aimed at her head, and he felt very angry because he didn't shoot her dead. William McGonagall. London, December 1859. Her Majesty disliked what she considered to be overheated homes. As a consequence, the many other occupants of the palace this chill December morning shivered as they moved from room to room going about their business. The Prince Consort himself suffered acutely from the cold. On the subject of maintaining proper fires in the scores of palace hearths, Albert's appeals to Victoria were unavailing. He rubbed his hands together, opening and clenching the fingers, trying to restore feeling as he read over the list on the desk before him yet again. The Prime Minister's aged First Lieutenant stood waiting, suppressing a rising urge to sneeze. "Yes," said Albert, turning the page around and sliding it across the desk toward the man from Downing Street. "This should do. Have the goodness to deliver it to the Minister." The old civil servant opened the battered attaché case used to convey messages of state to and from Downing Street. He drew the Queen's honours list toward him, his watery eyes flicking over the names of those to be knighted in the new year, stopping abruptly a quarter of the way down at a name that had not appeared in the Prime Minister's draft. Charles Robert Darwin. Only 3 weeks earlier, On the Origin of Species had been published to enormous uproar. The first edition had sold out in a day. The papers were full of it. The name of Darwin was praised, ridiculed, and thunderously reviled. The man from the ministry glanced up at the prince, who stared back steadily.
"Cold, is it not?"
said Albert, in his clipped German accent.
"Yes, indeed, sir. Quite."
Albert pushed back his chair and stood, signalling the dismissal of the man from the ministry. A thin rain fell all the afternoon, beginning to freeze as dusk approached. Around that hour, a messenger emerged from a great house in Whitehall, adjusting his cloak and scarf against the weather as he crossed the forecourt. He mounted the waiting curricle, its horses held by a groom. The messenger settled onto his seat and pulled on his riding gloves. He flicked a whip over the horses' heads and clattered off onto the slick streets for the road to Oxford, bearing an urgent communication for the bishop. There is scant historical record of the actions taken by a small body of like-minded men in response to the message in the courier's valise. Rumours circulated here and there for a time among members of the Court of Victoria, at Oxford, and within the Metropolitan Police. Whispers of a bizarre series of murders and one man's dogged pursuit of a killer. Perhaps the stories merely faded with time. Perhaps they were suppressed. But history is crystal clear on one point at least. Charles Darwin never received his knighthood. Part 1. 1. June 1860. The heat moved like a feral thing through the streets, fetid and inescapable. Chief Detective Inspector Charles Field, sweating in his shiny black greatcoat, ducked into the shadowed portico of a house near St. Albans Street, just bordering the Mall. Because of the view it offered, as well as the protection from the elements, it was the spot he invariably used to monitor royal processions along this stretch. The horses pulling the royal carriage plodded solemnly, resignedly, their tails flicking at the flies. Victoria and Albert, their faces glimpsed within the open coach, had a wilted look, but they seemed to be conversing nevertheless. Today, given the heat and the mundane nature of Her Majesty's errand, she and the Prince Consort were to open a public bath in the West End. The crowd was understandably thin. But because the Queen already had survived several attempts on her life, the royal coach was accompanied by a couple of the horse guard. A few police constables, Field's men, walked here and there along the route, watching the spectators and licking perspiration from beneath their moustaches. Inspector Field, his face glistening, clutched his stiff top hat behind his back. Tall, dark, and burly, he was clean-shaven, unlike most of his contemporaries, and gave the impression of not having been properly introduced to the clothing he wore. His shifting gaze touched each onlooker, one by one, and then came to rest on a skinny, threadbare figure on the curb directly before him. "I know you." Little Stevie Patchin was an 18-year-old pickpocket and occasional purveyor of stolen goods. Field and his men had hauled him before the magistrates more than once. Hatchet Face, as Stevie was known to his intimates, was a very small fish in London's large pond of criminality. But what was he doing here among these mostly provincial sightseers? And what was he holding in a bundle of rags wrapped round his right hand? As the royal carriage drew abreast of him, Stevie's arm rose.
"Oi!"
shouted Field, starting to move.
"Stevie!"
The youth glanced nervously over his shoulder, saw the policeman bearing down on him, and flung away the bundle of rags. He hadn't run more than a couple of yards before Field tackled him, tumbling him and then immediately hauling him to his feet again and frog-marching him back toward St. Albans Street. The royal carriage continued slowly on.
"Leave off!"
cried Stevie. Field spun the lad around and shoved him against the railings of a grand house at number 44, St. Albans, introducing the back of his head to the iron rods. A fine spray spurted from Stevie's nose.
"Now look! I'm bleeding."
"It was a gun you just pitched away, was it not? Assassination? You're out of your depth, Stevie."
"This all you got to do now you're famous, Mr. Bucket? Persecute the lowly?"
"My name is Field, not Bucket. He's a fiction and I am real daylight fact, right here before you. Whatever do you have against the Queen?"
"I don't know what you're on about."
Stevie wiped his bloody nose with a sleeve.
"I'll tell you what you're about, young man. You're about the hangman's rope that is some day awaiting you, that's all. You know it, and I know it, and I'd wager your mother knew it too, to her sorrow, as you partook the maternal refreshment."
"Sod off!"
"I beg your pardon," said Field,
danger in his voice. Stevie's eyes darted furtively.
"Think you're so bleeding smart?"
A fearful thought occurred to the inspector.
"I'm looking at a decoy." "Damn," he muttered,
shoving the little man from him, and then abruptly running, pelting along the broad mall, scattering pigeons as he ran. The sudden crack of a pistol shot smote him like a blow.
"Oh, dear God."
Field sprinted down the dusty road, trying to make out what was happening. Another shot. He saw a confusion of blue and red and black surrounding the carriage, and heard the cries of men and frightened horses. A couple of onlookers had got someone on the ground, thrashing and cursing. The horses of the guard were rearing, and the coachman was trying to calm the steeds harnessed to the royal carriage. As Field came abreast of the entourage, he saw the Queen, flushed and wide-eyed, talking rapidly to her husband, gesturing and scanning the horror-struck crowd. And then Prince Albert's furious gaze came to rest directly on him. Inspector Field of the detective.
"Her Majesty's alive, anyway, although my own prospects are dim."
The figure on the ground was no longer struggling. A policeman sat on the man's chest, while others pinioned his arms and legs.
"Kilvert!"
cried Field, and one of the constables, a rail-thin, dour Welshman, appeared at his side.
"You and Llewellyn, see to it no other blighter in the crowd's got a bloody gun. I've got Hatchet Face back at St. Albans with a gun or something like it."
"Yes, sir."
There was a cry and the crack of a whip, and the black and gold carriage lurched into motion once again, making a wide arc and turning back toward the palace, its royal passengers seemingly safe after yet another assassination attempt. Field was running in roughly the same direction, back toward St. Albans, determined to find little Stevie and wrest from him a name, a face, a description. Stevie, however, as Charles Field, deep in his dark policeman's heart, already feared, was no longer available for questioning. What Field hadn't anticipated, however, was to find him just round the corner from where he'd left him. The young man sat beneath the wrought iron railings behind number 44, his back against the rods and his head resting on his left shoulder. His narrow face was tilted sideways to the pitiless sky, his waistcoat scarlet and glistening, his throat sliced to the bone. Inspector Field quickly looked up and down St. Albans Street, and then knelt in the widening pool of Stevie's blood. The young man's right hand was thrust into the pocket of his trousers. Field gently pulled Stevie's arm, and the hand emerged, fist still clenched. When he prized it open, a bloody sovereign dropped from the fingers. Field got to his feet, picking up the coin and grimacing at the sticky feel of wet at his knees and hands.
"You there!"
Two young constables Field didn't recognize ran toward him. One thrust the inspector against the railings and pinned him there with his truncheon.
"Whoa, now!" shouted Field. "Get your hands off!"
A liveried servant, wigless and unbuttoned, approached, carrying a toasting fork, looking both fierce and frightened.
"That's him!" he cried. "He did it! I saw it all!"
"Constable," said Field, "you must be new to the Metropolitan. I am Chief of Detectives. Do you understand me?"
The other policeman, crouching beside Stevie, looked up and said,
"He's dead, all right."
"Murderer!"
cried a woman from the corner. She and several others were approaching.
"I saw it all,"
repeated the servant from number 44 shrilly.
"You will release me this instant," shouted Field.
"I've work to do."
"I believe you've already done your work here, sir. You're half covered in blood, in case you hadn't noticed."
"I was inspecting the body, idiot."
Field glanced down, following the constable's pointed gaze, and saw that not only were his knees and hands wet with gore, but his shirt front and waistcoat were speckled with a fine red spray.
"He had a nosebleed, for God's sake."
The other constable rose to his feet, and as he did so, Stevie's head fell like a lid to the right, exposing vertebrae, oozing clusters of tubes, and a gaping hole where the left ear should have been.
"Good God," murmured Field.
"Nosebleed. Right, then."
In less than a moment, Inspector Field was roughly handcuffed to the iron fence, with the body at his feet. Meanwhile, the alarm surrounding the assassination attempt had risen, with bells sounding in the distance, horses' hooves pounding up and down the mall, and police whistles blowing. The crowd in St. Albans, watching Field's arrest and morbidly eyeing the nearly headless figure of young Hatchet Face, had grown. Police Constable Kilvert pushed his way through the throng.
"Josiah,"
cried the inspector,
"get me clear of these fools."
"Officers," said Kilvert, "you've made a grave mistake here. Just up from the provinces, aren't you? And soon to return at this rate."
The constables looked abashed, but the man in footman's livery was sputtering.
"It weren't no mistake. I was watching from the window all morning, and there wasn't nobody but him in the road. Him and the bloke he'd done for."
"That's enough out of you, brass buttons. This man here is Detective Field."
Kilvert grew indignant.
"Mr. Charles Dickens called him Bucket."
"Shut up, Kilvert," said Field.
"Inspector Bucket of the detective."
"Kilvert, you arse," said Field. "Just get me out of this."
As the inspector was released, there was renewed scrutiny from the crowd. It was clear that many of them had heard of Dickens' fictional detective. For a person who did not, in fact, exist, Mr. Bucket was quite the celebrity, and so was his model.
"I don't care who he is," cried the woman from the corner. "He's been a murderer in the populace."
"You there,"
said Field, thrusting a large forefinger at the liveried servant.
"You're going to tell me what you saw from the window, lad. That's what you're going to do."
The young man with the brass buttons, somewhat abashed by the turn of events, muttered,
"You know what I saw."
I do not, in point of fact. I know what I saw, but I have a keen interest in your observations. Go on. You were watching, you say? You saw no one but me and this fellow?
That's right. Just you and him. And you weren't pounding him. Oh, no, you weren't.
The onlookers murmured ominously. Field put a fatherly arm round the servant's narrow shoulders, causing the young man to shudder.
What's your name, son?
Looking as though he wasn't eager to expand the acquaintance, he replied,
Willis.
Right then, Willis. You saw no one but me and...
He tilted his head in the direction of the corpse.
No passers-by? No tradesmen? Not so much as a nurse pushing a pram?
Not to mention, no. I mean, there was an old lady just now.
How old was she, Willis?
Willis glanced over his shoulder at the crowd and felt their support.
126, sir.
The laughter was universal, and no one seemed more pleased than Inspector Field.
Delightful, lad, he said, beaming. So, we got one crone, we got me and the dead bloke, and that's all. That's it. There ain't no more. We can all go home now. Is that right, young Willis?
Willis was beginning to enjoy the show.
That's about it, sir. Oh, there was a dog. I was forgetting the dog.
Gusts of laughter from the crowd.
The dog could be important, Willis. You never know, said Field, still smiling and nodding. What was the dog doing?
Groans now from the crowd, whose impression of the police as a bunch of sorry buffoons was being confirmed.
Doing? Said Willis. Dog was doing his business, wasn't he?
Laughter, tinged with scorn.
Doing his business and sniffing up the butcher's man, just like always.
Which butcher's man was this now, Willis?
Comes every second day, don't he? Brings a joint to number 42.
Field flicked the merest glance at Kilvert, who nodded and moved quietly through the crowd toward number 42, St. Albans.
I see, said Field. Comes every other day, wheeling a barrow with a joint or a haunch, and the dogs all love him 'cause his apron's covered in blood. Is that about right, Willis, my boy?
That's about it, sir,
cried Willis triumphantly, looking around and grinning as though he were about to take a bow. The crowd, however, or at least a number of them, had assumed more thoughtful expressions and did not look as likely to applaud as they had a moment ago. Police Constable Sam Llewellyn, a black-haired, pink-cheeked lad from Abergavenny, arrived breathlessly.
Sir, you're wanted.
Llewellyn's gaze fell on the body of Stevie Patchen.
Good Lord, where in God's name has the blighters left you?
Well, I haven't got it, Mr. Llewellyn. Get the crowd back and have a look round. Also, Stevie threw a bundle into the bushes back there. Find it.
Yes, sir. I was sent to fetch you, sir. You're wanted at the palace.
His voice dropped to an undertone.
It seems the royal family is not best pleased.
I imagine not, muttered Field. Thank you, Willis. You've been most entertaining.
To the policeman who had arrested him, he said,
Cover the corpse decent, you lot, and wait with him till the coroner arrives. My men, Llewellyn and Kilvert, are in charge here. You answer to them.
Where is Mr. Kilvert, sir? Said Llewellyn.
He stepped round to number 42. What did you make of the fellow who took the shots at Her Majesty?
Lunatic.
Like the others, you mean? Said Field,
and Llewellyn nodded.
But Sam, the assassin wasn't acting alone, was he? I'm guessing little Stevie here was set on deliberate to get me out of the way, and the gun I thought he was raising against the Queen will turn out to be a lump of coal or something like that. Come to that, if any of us had seen Hatchet Face pointing a bundle of rags in Her Majesty's direction, he would have had our full attention, I think you'll agree. Whoever engaged Stevie promised him a sovereign if he was successful in distracting the police.
Field held up the bloody coin he'd found in the corpse's pocket.
This one. Whoever did that was dressed in a butcher's blood-stained clothes and pushing a butcher's barrow. Meet me here, Stevie, says the bloke, after you've foxed Mr. Bucket. I'll give you this shiny coin. Which he does, and whilst Stevie stuffs it in his pocket, the butcher slices his throat. The body was supposed to go in the barrow, covered with a butcher's cloth and wheeled far away. Only something interrupts the killer and he's got to make off quick, leaving Stevie where he lay. What about the year? Haven't got a clue, have I? But I reckon Kilvert will find the kitchen at number 42 in a state, because of the usual butcher never arriving this morning. Don't you see? For the first time in all these attempts on Her Majesty's life, we've got a real live conspiracy. But instead of hunting it down, I've got to go and squander precious breath on a gaggle of court folk. With that, Inspector Charles Field turned and strode through the staring crowd. Whatever has become of my hat, he muttered under his breath. Never mind. Too bloody hot in any case. Constable Kilvert found distress in the kitchen at number 42 St. Albans, just as Inspector Field had predicted. Cook, indeed, had been expecting a leg of lamb and a half dozen hens for her mistress's supper party. They were never delivered.
Just put yourself in my place, officer, if you will. What am I to do now, with guests expected, and mistress such a sharp un?
Kilvert had a suspicion that Cook, an ample woman in her forties, was rather a sharp un herself, as a little kitchen maid's red eyes and soggy handkerchief testified.
There, there, Cook, said Kilvert, in low, comforting tones. Perhaps the butcher was delayed by the commotion in the mall. He'll come by and by.
I have me doubts, officer, shrilled the woman. The man drinks.
Shocking. Kilvert was, in fact, a teetotaler. Strong drink made him bilious. Moments later, he rejoined Llewellyn at the crime scene. A wagon had drawn up to receive the corpse of Stevie Patchen, and the coroner's men were supervising the operation. Look at this, Josiah, said Llewellyn, showing him a crude toy gun made from two wooden blocks, nestled in a bundle of rags. Found it in the bushes, just like Mr. Field said I would.
He's a wonder, is Mr. Field. Any sign of the missing ear?
Llewellyn shook his head.
Sam, said Kilvert, where would you go to find a drunken butcher?
Let me think for a moment, said his partner,
as though people were forever asking him just this. In the shimmering midday heat, the butcher stalls of Smithfield Market reeked of flesh and blood and dung. On the street, sewage moved sluggishly through narrow channels toward open drains. Smoke rose from a dozen firepots, blurring vision, tickling the throat, and muffling the cries of those who still labored here. Recently, much of the market had been shut down, following years of protest at the stench and the cruel treatment of the beasts, protests led in part by Charles Dickens. There were now more humane slaughterhouses in the northern borough of Islington. To the public, though, Smithfield remained synonymous with meat, and a contingent of the worshipful Company of Butchers Guild continued there, even as railway tracks were being laid near the site and construction begun on a new market. The area had resounded with the cries of men and dying cattle for nearly 1,000 years. Now there was the additional din of construction. Tom Ginty, aged 14, butcher's apprentice, ginger-haired and freckled, blinked sweat from his eyes as he collected offal from the hog that his master, Jake Figgis, was jointing. The other butcher attached to his stall had gone off early that morning and not returned.
Drunk again, said Jake.
So Tom's workload was heavier than normal. But he knew how lucky he was. To have a chance of someday becoming an intimate of the Butcher's Guild was more than enviable. It was only because of his dead father having been mates with a few of the worshipful company that he'd been accepted as prentice. That, and a payment of £1.6 that his mother had conjured from God knows where. Tom knew that if he were to put one foot wrong, there would be a score of lads waiting to take his place. Which was one of the reasons he was reluctant to say anything to anyone about the man who struck him as odd. Tom took him at first for another butcher because of the bloody apron he wore, but he didn't move right for a working man. He seemed to glide, as though he were on skates, crossing a frozen pond. His smile seemed frozen as well, Tom thought, as he glanced up from his work and shoved his sweat-matted red hair back from his eyes.
Like he's living in a cool day somewheres else,
but he ain't enjoying it, smile or no. Like he's this toff who just stepped in shit.
Tom's eyes dropped down to the man's feet.
Red shoes?
But they weren't shoes. They were made of cloth, like a baby's booty, only red. Or mostly red. And now the man, it's a gentleman, no mistake, the way he moves. Weaving his way through the crowd, paused, stooped, and undid the strings at his ankles. When he stood and moved on, he'd left the red things behind and was wearing gleaming black leather shoes. The scraps of red cloth were quickly trod over by the shifting throng and were lost to Tom's view. The gliding man's smile remained unchanged.
He's coming this way.
Tom felt a tingle of fear. Maybe it was the fixed smile. Tom looked up at Jake, who, drenched in sweat, was still fully engaged with the hog. When Tom looked back, the gentleman was gone, vanished, lost to the ever-moving crowd of buyers and sellers. Tom felt a huge wave of relief and wondered why.
It's the heat, isn't it?
Something white fluttered past his line of sight. It was reflex. Offal bucket in one hand, Tom put out his other and caught the flying cloth before it hit the pile of bloody rags that accumulated each day behind the butcher's stall. It was wet and red and sticky. Tom looked up in time to see the gliding man, now apronless, as he glanced back over his shoulder. In time to see the man with coal black eyes return his stare. In time to see a frown suddenly cross the smiling face. The gentleman, never releasing the boy from his intense gaze, smiled again, put a finger to his lips, and shook his head. Then he turned and glided on into the crowd. 2. Inspector Field sat gingerly on the flimsy, ornate chair on which he'd been placed, hoping it wouldn't shatter beneath him. He'd been led to this gilt room in the palace by Commissioner Maine and Sir Horace Dugdale, a member of the royal household. Sir Horace was watchful and almost entirely mute. Maine was angry.
"A conspiracy," said Maine, incredulously.
"At least three in it, sir," said Field. "The shooter, the decoy, and whoever set it up and topped the decoy. I have talked to the shooter, or tried. He's raving. The man could not conspire to do up his boots. Even if he is insane, that don't mean he acted alone."
Field, easily angered, checked his rising heat and lowered his voice.
"He might have been recruited because he was off."
That Detective Inspector Charles Frederick Field should find himself in Buckingham Palace, even to receive a dressing down, was something of a miracle. The son of a sometime publican in Chelsea, Field had nourished high ambitions as a boy. But they did not lie in this direction. There were few people on earth, apart from his wife, who knew that, as a young man, Charles Field had wanted more than anything to be an actor. A life on the stage would be his escape from the sour brutality of his parental home. In pursuit of his passion, Field had committed to memory long stretches of Shakespeare. He created disguises for himself and went out in public as a whole gallery of characters. He adopted alien accents and strange walks. A beloved sister, long since dead of typhoid fever, used to fashion his costumes late at night when her own work was done. Young Charles Field went out as rich man, poor man, beggar man, thief. One day his father, drunk since the night before, caught him at it yet again, posing as a young gentleman, and beat him senseless. Bloodied and bruised, Field left his hated home and his much-loved sister to fend for himself. He was 15 years old when he became a member of the Bow Street Runners, London's ragtag prototype of organised law enforcement. When the Metropolitan Police Force was established in 1829, Field signed on. Its first commissioner was Sir Robert Peel, and the public, immediately suspicious of this new force, began calling the constables Peelers, in dubious tribute to Sir Robert. Since then, Field had risen through the ranks. He had solved some of the most notorious murders of his day. And then he'd been discovered by the wide-ranging novelist and commentator on London life, Charles Dickens. The novelist had merely followed the inspector through night patrols of the city's most squalid and dangerous neighbourhoods, and recorded Field's interactions with the rogues and criminals he encountered. Dickens' On Duty with Inspector Field, published in Household Words in 1851, created a sensation. The inspector himself, however, couldn't understand it.
"It's not me," he told his wife.
The detective read and reread the account, baffled. "It's pure invention. It's not a bit like me."
"Never mind, Mr. Field," she said. "It's made a famous man of you."
Jane Field's observation became even more true in the wake of the 1853 publication of Dickens' Bleak House, and the appearance of the morally ambiguous Detective Inspector Bucket on the world stage. Everyone knew the character had to have been modelled on Field. Now, years later, the publican's son sat in the palace, arguing his position with knights of the realm. And then, shockingly, Prince Albert himself walked into the room, unexpected and unannounced, and Field saw his career coming to an abrupt end. He fell silent and stood with the other two men.
"That's done it. I'm through. The wife is going to be upset, poor girl."
Field had caught glimpses of the prince over the years. He remembered Albert as a strikingly handsome young man, with almond-shaped, piercing blue eyes, a trim little moustache, and thick, dark head of hair, erect of bearing and slender of build. Now the man before him, at age 40, was considerably altered. His hair thinning and combed over, he had sallow, puffy skin and a weary stoop. He still possessed the penetrating blue eyes, but what a contrast he made to his vivaciously plump and healthy queen. Prince Albert seemed to be studying Field as well.
"Her Majesty is recovering from a grave shock," he said finally.
Commissioner Mayne and Sir Horace both bowed their heads, and Field followed suit. He had never heard the man speak before. He was surprised by the thickness of his German accent.
"Fortunately, she is endowed with great strength. Unfortunately, she has had to endure this sort of shock on more than one occasion in the past." "Am I supposed to apologize?" "No. Don't speak unless he asks you a direct question." "Please, God, don't let him ask me a direct question." "Detective Field, as I saw this morning's events, you arrived late and you left early. Turned tail and ran, as a matter of fact. Take me out and shoot me, please. Draw me, quarter me, anything but this. I was most distressed by what I observed of your behaviour. Now, however, I see that you are quite literally covered in what I can only imagine to be blood. So there must be more to the story, is that so? You had reasons for acting as you did?" "I did, sir. A common criminal, known to me, was planted in the crowd on purpose so I'd find him, sir. Or so I now believe. Thereby I was took out of the way, sir." "If this were true, it would suggest conspiracy rather than lunacy," said Albert, glancing at Commissioner Mayne. "What leads you to believe this, Field?" "Because of the bloke, individual, being found by myself moments later with his head halfway sawed off, sir."
Mayne cleared his throat and said,
"Sir, if I may, we believe this to be an unrelated matter. We have the actual assailant under lock and key, sir. I assure you the man is quite mad. He is incapable of conspiring with anyone, I would say, but he will no longer pose a threat to the crown."
The Prince Consort's eyes flashed with sudden anger.
"No, indeed, Commissioner. Nor will he be properly punished for his actions. He will be found innocent by reason of insanity, and cosseted in an asylum, whilst you and I and all the world know he's anything but innocent."
Albert pointedly turned back to the inspector.
"Mr. Charles Dickens has written about you and your detective work, sir. Her Majesty and I have quite enjoyed his accounts of your manner of dealing with the criminal classes."
The prince's small mouth turned up in what the detective took to be a smile.
"Mr. Bucket is a thoroughly unforgettable character. Not entirely savoury in his practices, but highly entertaining."
The little head tilt seemed to be working, so Field repeated it.
"Her Majesty saw you this morning, Field. Even in all the tumult and danger, Her Majesty took note of you.
The Queen said, "Oh, look, there's the bucket fellow." The Queen has a regard for your fictional self, and it caused dismay to see you run off as you did. I shall attempt to explain your actions as you've explained them to me. The prince moved toward the door. It would be a shame to see the real Mr. Bucket fall from favour. With a tart nod to Commissioner Mayne and Sir Horace, the prince was gone. The commissioner turned to his subordinate. "Come along, Mr. Bucket. I've got a conspirator I'd like you to meet."
3. A turnkey led them through the crowded maze that was Newgate Prison. It was a clamorous place, a little city in itself, with guards leading shuffling knots of manacled prisoners to and from work details, and wives and children coming and going, bringing food and drink to incarcerated family members. Commissioner Mayne was speaking furiously above the din.
"As though little Stevie Patchen didn't have at any given moment in his miserable life a dozen enemies at the least, eager to do him in, queuing up for the privilege. He was a two-faced, two-timing, lying, backstabbing son of a whore."
Sir Horace Dugdale, following behind, made it clear by his placid demeanour that such language was quite inaudible to members of the royal household.
"The miracle is that it took this long for someone to go and actually do it," continued Mayne. "Am I wrong, Field?"
"Of course not, sir," said Field, in what he hoped were conciliatory tones.
The jailer stopped before an iron door, turned the key, and swung it open. A draught of cool, dank air swept out. The young man within, perhaps 25 years old, looked up from the bench on which he sat with his hands splayed on his thighs.
"I keep my mother's teeth in a jar," he said, his tone pleasant.
"Do you now?" said Field. "Does she not need them?"
The young man smiled wistfully and shook his head.
"Not where she is."
His bland, hairless face was bruised, and one ear was stained with dry blood. His clothing, too, had been torn and soiled in the scuffle during his arrest. The constant movement of his tongue within his mouth suggested a missing tooth.
"What's your name, lad?" said Field, gently.
Commissioner Mayne answered,
"Philip David Rendell, 26 years of age, a bookkeeper until recently. Abandoned his position and his lodgings in Islington a month or so ago. Dropped out of sight altogether."
"Son,"
said Field, as though the commissioner hadn't spoken.
"Your name?"
"Philip, sir."
"Is your mother in heaven, Philip?"
The young man barked with sudden laughter.
"Not her. She got herself into a cupboard and couldn't get out, the cunt."
Mayne groaned, while Sir Horace examined the ceiling.
"Why did you fire those shots this morning, Philip?" asked Field, unperturbed.
"Angel told me to shoot."
Commissioner Mayne snorted.
"Perhaps it was a conspiracy of angels."
"What did the angel look like, Philip?"
"Eyes like coals, and the glory of the Lord shone round about him."
"Was he a big man, like me?
Or a smallish one, like—"
Field's eyes strayed toward Commissioner Mayne, but then he thought better of it.
"Tall enough," said Philip Rendell sternly, looking Field up and down. "But you, sir, are no angel."
"Too true," said the inspector, ruefully shaking his head. "Too true. Where'd you get the gun from, lad?"
"Angel give it me."
A truculent note had come into the man's voice.
"See, there's a spectre haunting us."
"Is there now? Is the Queen a spectre, Philip?"
"The Queen?"
said the young man incredulously.
"Not likely."
"What's the spectre then, lad?" asked Field.
But Rendell put a finger to his lips and winked.
"Did the angel tell you to put your mother in a cupboard, Philip? Did he tell you to take her teeth and keep them in a jar?"
But the young man had lost all interest in visitors, evidently. He yawned wetly, leaned back against the wall, and closed his eyes. Field turned quietly to his superior.
"We might just check on the missing mother. You never know, sir. Actually, Detective Inspector Bucket, in this case we do know. Mother died in surgery at St. Thomas Hospital 2 months ago.
We believe the gun belonged to her late husband and is not of angelic origin. Now, is there any other line of inquiry you'd care to pursue with your conspirator?" The inspector blinked rapidly, mortified. It wasn't often he allowed himself to be taken by surprise. He turned back to Rendell. "Angel have a name, Philip?" But Philip's eyes were squeezed tightly shut. Field briefly considered picking the young man up by his ears and flinging him about the room, but restrained himself. Sir Horace cleared his throat significantly, and Commissioner Main said, not unkindly, "Charles, there really is no point." Field leaned in toward the young man. "Philip, you missed the Queen. Shot twice and missed her twice. Why is that, do you suppose? You were very near to the royal carriage." Rendell's eyes flew open.
"Wasn't the Queen, fool?"
"Yes, it was, though, Philip. It was indeed Victoria, our Queen, at whom you fired two shots."
"You don't understand. Now the Angel will be wroth with me. He has a flaming sword, you know."
Field sighed and glanced up at his superior. Main, in turn, gave the jailer a nod, and the men filed out of the cell, leaving the prisoner alone. At the door, Field turned back. The bland-faced young man was staring at him, wide-eyed.
"Keep clear of his blade,"
he cried.
"Once cut, always kept."
4. Oxford.
"A hat's shape is not the hat, nor yet is the colour of the hat the hat."
Samuel Wilberforce, Bishop of Oxford, walked beside the Isis with one of his undergraduates, David Gates, a compact, fair-haired and earnest young man of 19. The bishop generally was able to convey basic philosophical precepts while thinking of other things altogether, letting his mind and eye wander, unimpeded by the pedagogical flow, which was, after all, to him, old hat. Not so young David, who strained to listen and to understand, his commoner's gown clinging sweatily to his shoulders. A summer storm threatened, the clouds massing and shifting greenly above the Christchurch meadow, the sky swelling with heat. The son of abolitionist William Wilberforce, Samuel had distinguished himself in the Oxford Debating Society, leaving university with a first in mathematics and a second in the classics, to begin life as a rural curate. The young Wilberforce quickly attracted attention through his writings, Notebook of a Country Clergyman, and On Correcting the Prejudices of the Lower Order of Farmers. He rose through the ranks to vicar and then to subdeacon. In 1841, Wilberforce was made chaplain to Prince Albert, and his future success was assured. He soon accepted the deanery of Westminster and the bishopric of Oxford, becoming eventually a peer of the realm. At this time, the so-called Oxford movement was giving birth to itself, with Anglican intellectuals embracing high church ritual and flirting ever more brazenly with the Church of Rome. Wilberforce himself was high church, but, as a cautious man, not too high.
"The size of the hat," continued Wilberforce, "the material of which the hat is constructed, these are not the hat. These, we say, are accidents attendant upon the hat. They do not constitute the substance of the hat."
The bishop, glancing into the punt gliding slowly toward them on the river, took note of the young female passenger's pleasantly shaped bosom.
"But the shape and size of her breasts are not her breasts."
"Nothing," said Wilberforce, a little distantly, "pertaining to the senses constitutes the substance of the hat."
"But, sir," said David, a scholarship student from Orpington, "are the senses to be dismissed altogether? Are the senses useless? Surely not. Is that Conrad in the punt with the girl? No. Jenkins? Whoever he is, she's a delectable catch and seems to be enjoying her champagne."
"Sir?"
Wilberforce tore his eyes from the nearing punt.
"Yes, Gates?" "It just seems to me, sir, that the church strains to redefine substance merely in order to justify the doctrine of transubstantiation,
In order to get the true body and blood, we have to throw out common sense, which feels to me like the rejection of a great gift." The imagined nipples of the young punt passenger were fading from the bishop's mind. "Tiresome young man." Wilberforce rubbed his hands together in his signature fashion, as though washing them, preparatory to crushing his opponent. Because of this tic, he was widely known, behind his ample back, as Soapy Sam. "The body and blood are the gifts," said the bishop. "Compared with the real presence of the body and blood of our Lord, your common sense is a paltry thing." There were running footsteps approaching from a distance, crunching on the gravel walk. The men looked up to see an undergraduate hurrying toward them, his black gown flapping behind. David involuntarily caught his breath. It was his friend from Jesus College, Jack Callow.
"I say, David, have you heard?"
shouted Jack, and then he recognized the portly, jowly man at David's side. Jack abruptly slowed his run to a walk.
"Sorry, my lord. Forgive me."
"Heard what, young man?" said the bishop. The two undergraduates stood flanking Wilberforce, glancing at each other awkwardly.
"It seems they've gone and tried to kill the Queen again, my lord. This morning, in fact."
David saw the colour drain from the bishop's face, and remembered that the man was, after all, an ecclesiastical adviser to Victoria.
"Sir," said David, "may I introduce my friend from Jesus, Mr. Jack Callow?"
Jack, tall, fine-featured, with dark, tightly curled hair, smiled and bowed. The bishop's normally powerful voice faltered.
"The attempt was?"
"Unsuccessful, sir. Missed the Queen altogether."
"And the prince?"
"As far as I've heard, sir, yes, thank God." The Bishop of Oxford closed his eyes, breathing heavily. David and Jack glanced at each other.
"Perhaps, my lord, you'd like to sit," said David. "There's a bench just here."
Samuel Wilberforce opened his eyes in time to see the punt with the young woman in it taking a bend in the river. A moment before she disappeared, the woman clutched the side of the punt, shuddered, and vomited over the side. Wilberforce's head swam.
"Sir," said David, clutching the bishop's elbow. "Sir, you're not well. Jack, fetch assistance."
"No," said Wilberforce, urgency in his voice.
"I must return to my rooms. There are letters to be written. There are people with whom I must speak."
The man lurched forward unsteadily, sweat streaming down his face. David offered an arm, which the bishop grasped heavily.
"I say," said Jack, "that's a nasty-looking sky. We need to hurry along."
Wilberforce seemed to be looking into a great distance as he stumbled on.
"We shall be raised," he whispered.
There was a flash of white light and a deafening crack of thunder.
"Raised incorruptible."
As David and Jack struggled to help the bishop across Christchurch Meadow, the heavens opened and the rain came down. 5. London. By the end of the day, young Tom Ginty was ready to jump out of his skin. The man with the frozen smile was still there, somewhere. Tom knew it. It wasn't a matter of seeing the deep-set eyes he knew were watching him. Instead, he felt them on his person, as real as importunate fingers, touching him immodestly, intimately, again and again. But as often as he'd wheel about to look, the sensation would vanish. It was late afternoon and the sky was ominous. Throughout the market, people were closing stalls and cleaning them, everyone eager to be off before the threatened storm broke. Tom filled two large pails of water from the pump in the centre of the market and carried them on a yoke over his shoulders to the stalls where Jake Figgis awaited him impatiently.
"You took your time."
"Sorry, sir."
Tom sluiced water over the butcher's chopping blocks. He scraped them with a blade and scrubbed them with a wire brush before sluicing them again. Jake, meanwhile, gathered the day's soiled rags and butcher's aprons into a bundle for the waiting washerwoman. A maiden of 13 years, who brazenly winked at Tom and made a flirtatious comment about his muscular arms and ginger curls before moving off, her barrow stacked high with the wash she'd be working on until dawn.
"Gentleman was asking after you, Tom," said Jake,
changing out of his work clothes and into his street gear. Tom froze.
"What?"
asked your name, said he was kin of your mum.
A gentleman?
Tall man, big black eyes.
Noting the look on Tom's face, Jake said,
Oh, you know all about him, do you?
Tom shook his head.
Never mind, he said he'd be back for you tomorrow.
Tom felt ice at his belly.
Did he walk like a lady?
He asked, his eyes wide.
Did he what?
Did the man sort of skate like?
Don't know what you're on about, do I? Cheerio, Tom.
Jake chucked the boy under his chin and strode out into the evening. From Smithfield Market to Cock Lane, where Tom lived with his mother above the fortune of war, it was only a matter of steps. Tonight, though, it felt like a treacherous distance. Thunder rumbled ever closer. The golden figurine of the chubby boy at the corner of Giltspur and Cock, a commemoration of the Great Fire of 1666, was normally the welcome sign that Tom was home again. Tonight, it accused Tom of nameless sins for which he soon would be punished. His mother, Martha Ginty, sat him down in the scullery with a glass of beer, a half-loaf of bread, and a slice of cheese before hurrying back into the noisy, smoky fortune of war. When she returned carrying a tray laden with empty tankards, Tom was staring, his food untouched. Martha anxiously clapped a hand to her boy's forehead.
"Do we have any gentlefolk for kin, Mum?"
"Not likely," said Martha. "What's wrong with you, then?"
"I don't want to go to the market tomorrow,"
muttered Tom. Martha Ginty's laugh was a bark.
"That's rich."
By the age of 32, Martha had lost both her husband and her only other child, a girl, to typhoid fever just 2 years earlier. She loved Tom, her firstborn, with a ferocity that almost frightened her. But for persons of their class, there were no days off work, sick or no. Martha gave Tom a gentle cuff, which turned into an embrace.
"Now eat up," she said, "and to bed with you."
6. Charles Field sat naked in the tin bath at the centre of Mrs. Field's kitchen, scrubbing himself with a coarse brush. Jane Field, fair-haired, shapely, and some 15 years younger than her husband, poured another kettle of steaming water into the tub. The inspector followed her with his eyes, marvelling, as always, that this beauty with cheeks like apples and a keen, often frighteningly independent mind, was his very own wife. He had found her in the Crimea 5 years earlier, one of Miss Nightingale's pioneering nurses. Field had been sent out to the famous hospital at Scutari on a bizarre, highly secret mission. The peril from which he had rescued Jane then had left its mark on her. It took persistence and time for Field to win her confidence and her hand in marriage. But if the inspector was not invariably patient, he was always persistent.
"Used to be only the quality would try to kill a queen," said Jane. "The nobility and such. It was all very aristocratic and according to form. Look at Shakespeare. Now you've got Islington bookkeepers having a go. What is the world coming to?"
She leaned briefly into the passage and shouted up the stairs,
"Bessie!"
The Fields leased a house at No. 2 Bow Street, a down-at-heels red brick structure, just steps from where Mr. Field had begun his career with the Runners. They shared it with a serving girl named Bessie, and, to their unspoken sorrow, no children. Jane picked through the pile of her husband's discarded clothes with a pair of wooden tongs.
"Look at this shirt. Are you certain none of this blood is yours, Mr. Field?"
"My dear, I assure you it's little Stevie's blood alone. We had boys in the Crimea who had no idea they'd been shot," she said. "There was one who thought he'd barked his shin when half his foot was off."
She leaned out into the passage again.
"Bessie, where is that girl? Sent her out for chops a good while ago. I do hope she's all right."
Privately, Field thought it likely Bessie was doing all right by herself with a glass or two of gin on the way back from her errand. "The bookkeeper said something about a spectre haunting us," he said.
"A spectre?"
Footsteps pounding down the steps from the street door announced the breathless appearance in the kitchen of Bessie, bearing small parcels done up in oily brown paper. She was 29 years old, bug-eyed, warty, and, credible rumour had it, had never been kissed. Her apron was half off and her bonnet half on, hanks of her hair protruding from the bonnet like the many-headed hydra.
"Bessie, there you are,"
cried Jane.
"La, missus, where should I be?"
said Bessie in her habitually querulous tones.
"If missus sends me to fetch master's chops, what should I do but fetch 'em?"
Field could smell the gin from where he sat. Could it be that his wife did not?
"There, there, Bessie," said Jane. "No harm done. Shall I not fetch 'em? Some might not, I suppose," said the woman, on a rising note, with a hint of hysterics to follow.
It was one of Jane Field's enduring delusions that Bessie was, in fact, a treasure, and that the girl was at any moment liable to desert the household for a better position elsewhere.
"No, my dear girl," cried Jane. "Of course you give satisfaction, don't she, Mr. Field?"
"It's not unheard of," said that gentleman quietly.
"There's chops here," said Bessie, "and a nice piece of fish. But do I get any thanks for my trouble?"
"Nonsense, puss," said Jane,
taking the parcels from her and sniffing each in turn.
"Mr. Field met the prince today, Bessie. Prince Albert as ever was. Now, what do you think of master? And ain't you pleased to be in his service?" "I hope I know my place," said the serving girl, "and any respect what I owe the master."
Field pulled his knees to his chest.
"Mrs. Field, if we could perhaps move things along. I've had rather a long day and I'm hungry."
"Of course. Bessie, take Mr. Field's soiled things and put them in the copper to soak whilst I get started on these chops. There's a good girl."
Perhaps they're right, thought Field. Stevie had any number of mortal enemies. It all could have been a bizarre coincidence, and Stevie's murder nothing to do with the insane man who tried to kill the Queen. The sizzle and smell of the frying chops comforted him. He closed his eyes and dozed. Late that night, the newly refreshed detective lay back in his bed, exulting in the comfort of the bedclothes. Jane yawned and settled in close by his side.
"I imagine," Mrs. Field said, "that poor deranged man was just one of them new communist fellows, that's all."
"What's that, my dear?" Field said.
"Well, it's their motto, isn't it? Or something like it."
"What motto? Whose motto?"
"You know."
"I assure you, my dear, I have no idea."
"The communists."
"Communists? Mrs. Field, what's this about a motto?"
"They've got it printed on the broadsheets they pass out at market, don't they? There's a spectre haunting Europe, it says across the top, big as brass. It's called communism."
"Good night, my dear."
She passed quickly from consciousness to sleep. But Detective Inspector Field was suddenly awake and staring as lightning and thunder broke loudly over the city. 7. The lamps were dimmed, the royal servants banished. The two men stood at a wall of windows in the darkened room, watching the storm. Sudden, stabbing blue light created momentary vistas, disappearing in an instant. The lengthy silence between the men accentuated the sound of the rain pelting the windows and running in orderly channels across the roof beneath them.
"She is very strong." Prince Albert's voice was low. "I asked her if she would be able to sleep tonight, and she said, 'Why ever would I not be?'"
His companion, Sir Richard Owen, renowned professor of anatomy and one of the principal natural historians of the age, shook his head in wonder. A flash of lightning was followed almost immediately by a deafening peal of thunder. For less than a second, every tree in St. James Park was revealed.
"What can explain it? She is benevolent and good-hearted. As far as I can tell, her subjects love her. Why should these devils wish to harm her?"
Sir Richard Owen pursed his lips and shook his head sadly, mutely grieving the inexplicable wickedness of the world.
"Of me," said Albert with a rueful laugh. "The people are not so fond."
A dissenting murmur from his companion.
"No, no. Owen, there are those in this realm who detest me. This is not a matter for debate. I am the foreigner, the German who stole their princess from them. I am the introducer of strange un-English ideas. Your great exhibition changed all that, sir, said Owen. 10 years later, does anyone care? Oh, how the great men opposed me and my exhibition. It was all a conspiracy to give away the secrets of British industry to the world. Because, of course, no one knows anything but the British, and the British have nothing to learn from anyone, ever.
The Crystal Palace exhibition of 1851 had been condemned from the pulpit. Members of Parliament had proclaimed their hope that it would fail. The aristocracy in particular had been sceptical. Many of them, in fact, did loathe the German prince. He was stiff in society. His demeanour revealed the contempt he had for it. As it happened, the international display of technological advances had been a stunning success with the general public and with visitors from around the world. Millions had attended. The exhibition more than paid for itself, and in 1854 the entire massive glass structure was disassembled and moved from Hyde Park to Sydenham, south of the Thames.
I understand, Sir Richard, that your monstrous lizards still inspire fear amongst the matrons of Surrey.
Owen raised his eyebrows and smiled modestly.
Indeed, he said. There is even talk of erecting a similar menagerie in the Central Park of New York.
It was Owen who had coined the word dinosaur, and who was the first to classify the gigantic fossil remains of the terrible lizards, which were being discovered throughout the world. Both respected for his brilliance and feared for his competitive malice, Owen had a high forehead, a prominent narrow nose, thin lips, and a wife and son whom he rarely saw. Critics said that Owen had never acknowledged his debt to Gideon Mantell, a self-taught scholar from the lower classes whose earlier work with fossils had paved Owen's way. It was common knowledge that Owen had viciously fought the presentation of the Royal Society's medal to Mantell for his pioneering work. The man had been cruelly disfigured by disease, then a carriage accident, and lived in constant pain. Many were appalled when, following Mantell's death, Owen had the man's misshapen skeleton publicly displayed at the Royal College of Surgeons. What mattered to the prince, though, was that Owen had been a staunch supporter of his exhibition. Under Owen's direction, a sculptor had created massive full-scale models of a number of dinosaurs. At the exhibition's opening festivities, he had hosted a party entirely inside one of these models, a dinner for 21 guests, including Albert. "If something should happen to the Queen," said Albert abruptly, "what would become of the nation? Could Bertie govern?"
"At last we come to it. The shooting today has put him in mind of mortality and royal succession."
Owen had tutored the royal children when they were younger, and he considered the eldest boy, Albert, Prince of Wales and heir to the throne, to be dull, indolent, and vain.
"With proper guidance, I believe he could, sir," he said.
"With guidance from whom, Owen? From you?
Let us assume for the moment that both the Queen and I were absent from the scene."
"No, no, no. One must have clarity, Sir Richard, and courage. Could our eldest son assume the throne and acquit himself honourably?" Owen was silent, and the prince nodded grimly.
"So, this is our dilemma. I plan to take the Queen to Coburg in September to visit my homeland. Must we take Bertie with us, to keep him in line?"
"I am sure it would be instructive for him.
Perhaps we will send him to America. He's been invited often enough. He would need a chaperone, of course, and Bishop Wilberforce, alas, has risen too high in the world to be of service. We had a letter from him this afternoon, quite upset over the events of the morning."
"Of course, sir. So were we all."
"Wilberforce, too, expresses interest in the Prince of Wales."
Albert gazed thoughtfully at Owen.
"The bishop is going ahead with this debate at Oxford, or perhaps you were already aware of this."
"Indeed."
"Will Mr. Darwin participate?"
"It is uncertain," said Owen. "There is the matter of his health, you know. In any case, Wilberforce will be going up against Huxley, God help him.
The Bishop of Oxford is quite a capable debater, sir. I shouldn't worry about him."
Albert snorted.
Worry about Soapy Sam? I certainly shall not.
Owen stiffened.
I myself will be coaching the bishop for this debate in matters of comparative anatomy.
Will you indeed, Owen? What is it you people have against Darwin?
I, sir? I have known Charles Darwin for 20 years. I believe I may say, in all modesty, that he looks up to me as a guiding light. I have nothing against the man.
Do you not?
You people came down rather hard on us when the Queen wished to bestow a knighthood on him. That, sir, was Bishop Wilberforce, not I. I believe Darwin to be a scholar and a gentleman who has simply drawn seriously mistaken conclusions from his rather admirable researches. Bishop Wilberforce is obliged, of course, by his vocation to object to the man's conclusions. Nothing to do with his vocation, I should have thought. Matter of science. Facts and figures, not religion. In this, sir, I am afraid we disagree. The lines between the two may seem to be parallel, but ultimately there is one line that intersects all others.
Wouldn't think the Lord God Almighty needed Sam Wilberforce defending him, but then he's got pluck. Wilberforce, I mean.
The storm had lessened, and the prince turned again to the windows, looking out.
I intend to put Darwin's name forward once more, in the next honours list. I mean to say, Her Majesty intends to do so.
Indeed.
Indeed,
repeated the prince, with the barest hint of an edge.
I am told he may be the greatest man of science these islands have produced since Newton. May I ask, sir,
said Owen, with an edge of his own,
who has compared Charles Darwin to Sir Isaac Newton? You are not the only respected natural historian who dines with us, Sir Richard.
He turned to Owen and added,
but you are one of the most esteemed.
Owen acknowledged both the rebuke and the compliment with a slight bow.
I've kept you late again, haven't I? But now you see the rain is stopping and you will have a better journey home.
Albert pulled a hidden lever, and a butler appeared instantly.
Have Sir Richard's carriage brought round.
The man inclined his head and vanished.
Do you know,
said the prince, stepping out into the hall,
we interviewed that detective fellow today. The real Mr. Bucket.
Indeed.
Detective Inspector Charles Field. I can see how Dickens might have become interested in the man. He is larger than life, somehow. Even in person, the man seems like fiction.
Albert moved crisply down the passage while Sir Richard hurried alongside.
Field thinks today's attempt upon the life of the Queen was not the work of a lone madman, but part of a conspiracy.
Does he now?
It seems there was a murder committed that is somehow connected.
Albert stopped at the head of a grand staircase.
Here, my friend, is where we part company.
Owen seemed suddenly at a loss.
Ah, yes. A conspiracy, you say? I do enjoy our little talks,
said Albert, oblivious. Even before Owen could bow, the Prince Consort was walking away, his upright form receding down a long, flickering hall of gilt and glass. A footman nearby coughed gently. Sir Richard Owen turned and followed him down the steps. It was well past midnight. The rain had stopped and a wind had risen. The temperature was dropping, and a half-moon was alternately revealed and hidden by ragged, fast-moving clouds. The Royal College of Surgeons at Lincoln's Inn Fields was mostly dark at this time of night, but far from empty. Row after row of mounted skeletons stared mutely at each other across the ages. Fetuses floated in countless glass vessels. In the cool vaults below, corpses lay waiting to offer up their secrets to the keen blades of the students and faculty. The tall young man, a living specimen known from childhood as the Chorister, glided up the staircase to the ground level. The night porter had given him the message that the professor had arrived and wished to see him, so Decimus Cobb had put down his instruments and made himself ready for the interview. Tonight, the Chorister knew his mentor would speak of the day's failure, and he knew he would be scolded for it. But what was he to do? His master was determined to keep himself and his cohorts far removed from the work they had assigned him, so he had been compelled to recruit a deniable agent, the lunatic Rendell, who, it transpired, could not shoot straight. If only they would give Decimus free rein. He wasn't
worried. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.